So, just to reiterate a couple things Mike said with regard to the altar, it is fixed in place. It needs to be fixed in place. And it is, there's only one altar in a church, and it's the center of all of the activities. And particularly, the Eucharist is where the altar, the Eucharist is the celebration that takes place on the altar. This is an example of an altar that is really, it has the old altar combination of pre-Vatican. So we have the altar that was originally part of the, before the Vatican Council took place in the 1960s. And then just after that, when it was determined that altars needed to be something where the priest could stand behind it, face the population, and say the mass, this is the combination that came along with that. And then, like Mike said, these big, large profile altars were still in place. And we know how many people actually, did we all grow up in the era when the priest said mass with his back? And I was thinking, some of you have not experienced that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we have some converts, too.
I have
really?
Not. I have
your converts.
Yeah, converts. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So yeah. I just didn't know. It's an age thing, and it's also a convert kind of thing. There. So this is the original place where masses took place. The priest had his back to us, spoke Latin. Wow. It was very, very disconnected from the...
What church is that one?
This one is internet. So it's
we're
just
not
something
sure.
I found online. It's not
Utah.
I searched for my images in.
It's not in Utah.
Not in Utah.
I've been there. I just don't remember where it is.
You probably have seen something.
I didn't go somewhere in Rome.
So major point is that the altar should be the focal point of the sanctuary. It should be freestanding so that the priest can move around it. It should be fixed in place. The ideal material for the table of mensa, as they refer to that mensa term, is the tabletop here. Should be made of natural stone, ideally representing Christ as the living stone. In the U.S., it is permissible to use other materials for the mensa, for the altar table. It should be the center of attention, visible to all, and not so elevated that there's a division between the assembly and the priest celebrant. Just elevated so that everyone can see, but not to be elevated and grandiose in any way, or as above the people, so to speak. Here are a couple of examples of altars. Both of these are online images I found. This one appears to be made of wood, and so it does not have to be. In the U.S., there's provisions that the altar does not have to be made of living stone, as we find this example, marble here. But often, marble is the choice, as it is at the Cathedral of the Netherlands. The ambo, otherwise known to us as the pulpit, should reflect the dignity and the nobility of the Word of God and should bear a close relationship to the altar, reflecting the relationship between the Word and the Eucharist. Those two things should be related in terms of the ambo and the altar. Some examples. Some examples of the relationship between the altar and the ambo. So in this case, an online image, you can see the materials the same, the designs the same, the ambo and the altar. This is another view of St. Catherine of Siena. We've got the Christ figure in the background here. Here we do have a wood altar. I just wanted to double check, and I went in there yesterday and it was completely covered by an altar cloth. But I could see the wood legs that were supporting the altar. So you've got a wood, the entire space sanctuary is devoted to wood. The ambo is wood, and so is the altar, and the altar looks beautiful. I've never seen it without a cover. So it's pretty remarkable.
And Marty?
Yeah.
I think, no, let's see if you agree, but I think there's discouragement in covering the slab with cloth.
Fully covered.
The history, I remember as a kid, you know, there was the Altar Society, and, you know, it was a cultural thing.
Yeah.
There was women that were in this group, and they took care of those linens, I mean, they.
Okay, so our church has this, and our ex-priest is from Colombia, and he's very.
We won't tell you who, though.
Your friend was there.
Our friend goes there, too.
Telling you for a friend, yeah. But so, I mean, that makes a lot of sense, and I mean, all the tablecloths are.
Altar cloths are different colors.
Yeah, different colors for the seasons and.
Exactly.
Yeah, anyway, sorry.
But if you go to the cathedral, you'll see a cloth that's laid on the top of the slab.
It doesn't entirely.
Appropriately, with no draping, it's, you know, there's no reason to hide.
The beauty of the altar.
The slab that they talk about, this living stone, so.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so the altar has its, it should be fixed in place, it should have a relationship to Nambo, and this is St. Thomas More, where we have a relationship, a spatial relationship between the two elements of the church. The chair of the priest celebrant is a symbol of his office, of the person that's celebrating. It should be visible to the entire congregation. Now, this is St. Mary of the Assumption in Park City. So we have the altar here, and the chair is located there, off to the side, so you can see it. It should be visible to the entire congregation, and is never intended that it be remote or grandiose. There should be a deacon's chair always placed next to the presider's, the celebrant's chair. And we have that here in this case. And in a cathedral, there is a very special chair called the cathedra. I'll speak about that in a moment in more detail. But the term cathedra is a Latin term that means, Latin and Greek term, it means chair. It is the term for chair in Latin and Greek. And so there's a special church featured in a cathedral church. It's the bishop's chair. It's indicating that's the home seat of the bishop of that diocese. And it's permanently set in place, and an indicator of that being the home seat. There's only one Catholic cathedral in the entire diocese of Salt Lake City, and it's the home church of this of our bishop. It's right across the street. It's
and nobody sits in it when he doesn't.
And he's the only one who sits there. They do not, no presider priests sit in another place in that separate spot. The baptistry, a very important part of the liturgical structures. Baptism is the first sacrament of initiation. It precedes the reception of the Eucharist. The location and design of the baptismal font should be should ideally demonstrate a connection to the altar. So in the cathedral, we've got that going for sure. At the Cathedral of the Madeleine, so here we have an example of, again, this is the ideal. We have the Cathedral of the Madeleine, the baptistry font is located and is the only place where we have holy water in the cathedral. We don't have the little side, fonts. We use the baptismal font directly, and it's right in front of the entrance intentionally. So it's the first reminder as you come into the church that baptism is the sacrament, the first sacrament, and eventually in time you proceed forward and move to the Eucharist, which is where the Mass is celebrated. We have another kind of baptismal font here. Wanted to point out that the number 8 is often associated with baptism. In the cathedral, we have an octagonal-shaped font, and the reason being that baptism sets the Christian on the path to what will end in the eighth or the eternal day. So we have our baptism, we practice our faith on earth, and then we are going to end up at the eternal day in heaven. We have some diagrams of churches here. the relationship between a baptismal font, all these circles are baptistries, and then the A stands for altar. So these are all various combinations of good ways of constructing, of relating the altar to the baptismal font. And these are good examples of how that should be done. The reservation of the Eucharist, the Code of Canon Law says that the Eucharist should be preserved in a part of the church that is distinguished, conspicuous, and beautifully decorated, and is suitable for prayer and veneration. In the cathedral, we have, someone asked about the reservation chapel. That is the space in which we reserve, where the tabernacle is centered, and it's a space where people can come and pray and pay reverence to the Eucharist in a quiet and private way. There should only be one tabernacle in each church. The location of the tabernacle, according to the general rules of the general instruction in the Roman Missal, it's more appropriate for a tabernacle to be, which is the place of reservation of the Eucharist, to not be on the altar. We've already made, Mike's made that distinction. It should not be on the main altar, in some other place. The bishop determines the location of the tabernacle, and that is in the ideal sense. For all practical purposes, the committee that Mike and I serve on, the liturgical, Diocese of Liturgical Art and Architecture Committee, are often involved in advising churches about where it would be best to place the tabernacle. We work under the bishop. He is the one that is to advise us as to where he would like to have tabernacles placed. And we have a sort of a running conversation with the bishop. We say, this is what this church would like to do. What do you advise? We have a conversation with him, and then we tell the people that have come to visit what the bishop thinks. So in practical purposes, it's the Liturgical Art and Architecture Committee that is very helpful, and that's our intention always, is to be helpful and not trying to discipline, or we want to be serving the greater community in terms of church building and construction.
Marty, very quickly, you use the term should a lot, and I understand it, but for example, there should be only one should be. Is it really should, or is it a must be one? And I understand that.
There's probably a technical difference. And
there should be one altar, or must there be only one altar, or there must be one tabernacle altar, or can you have two tabernacles, but it's only recommended to have one. I mean, should versus must.
What's must. The, there must be only one altar, is what I would say, absolutely.
Right.
And we have run into situations where we have had questions about could we have a separate tabernacle in a separate location. Very complicated.
Okay.
And so that one I can't answer.
I mean, it should not be on the altar. Well,
exactly.
We know that there are. So it's not recommended.
Yeah.
But
exactly.
It's not wrong. But
it's.
And
I think again that has to do with if there was a remodel, or certainly if it's a brand new church,
we would recommend no.
If in some of our little tiny missions, that's the only place for it. I mean, that's just the way it is. So,
A quick question. I went to Mexico City. The Cathedral of Our Lady Guadalupe has the main altar, but they had like six or seven altars in the very back.
Yeah.
Is that permissible now?
Well, I don't know. I assume that would be, I have never been there, but I assume that would be a church that has been in place for centuries. Mm-hmm. Possibly not. I don't know.
The Basilica of the Immaculate Conception in Washington, D.C., they have many altars.
But they're not celebrating Mass at the same time at all the altars.
Right.
I think that is part of it, is that the one, the one altar where the Eucharist is celebrated, as opposed to You can have all these other altars, but they're not being used for the
celebration. So it's okay to have other altars, just only one
celebration? Well, I think as Mark said, if they're existing, we would never tell a brand new church to do that at all.
Okay.
But there are many churches like that that were built before Vatican II that yes.
Well, St. Peter's Basilica has that.
Yeah.
So little tour groups go have their own little mass.
Sure.
And they were there before.
Yeah.
And they were there.
Before the documents.
Yeah.
There might be a question there, too, of whether the Blessed Sacrament is reserved in each
exactly,
of those places.
Exactly, right.
So may, I don't know this in the back, but my guess is that the Blessed Sacrament is reserved only one place. You can say Mass in a number of places.
That's true.
Reservation might only occur.
Well, and the Built of Living Stones is based on the United States, the bishops of the USCCB.
Right.
It could be something different in Mexico or Portugal or, I don't know.
We are a universal church.
We are, but ours is, these are based on
God. So we try to hold on to certain basic principles. So the location of the tabernacle.
That's the cathedral, right, Marnie?
Yes, it is. This is the tabernacle tower. Standing behind the beautiful carved screen, that is a wonderful way of separating Mass itself. Yep. So we've got the screen that Mike referred to in a couple of other churches, and the Mass, the altar is out here, the tabernacle is back here, and you can barely see the tower of the tabernacle when you're entering the church. So it's a separate space, and that's the intention.
You guys do morning prayer there in the Resurrection Chapel.
You were there last morning.
Has that always been there, or was that in the remodel?
That was in the remodel, 1993. And that's and I don't think enough can be said for the way that the remodel was done with regard to Monsignor Mannion. Really, he was under the bishop. Bishop Wiegand was the presiding bishop at the time. But Monsignor Mannion did the yeoman's job of really doing all the hard work with the cathedral parish. And I interviewed Monsignor Mannion for this book that I'm working on, and he said the only way it could work was if you had many, many, many classes, different people come in, different experts advise. And he said, I had so many that I'd go back to Bishop Wiegand and I'd say, is this okay? Is that okay? And finally he said, stop asking me. You're doing a great job of educating and pulling in the people. So keep moving in that direction. And that's, I think, to a large degree, why the cathedral came out so beautifully. Monsignor Mannion's needs to be mentioned at the end of his life as one of the great accomplishments. So we have the location of the tabernacle in a special place. And the Chapel of Reservation, the bishop may direct the parish as to where the Blessed Sacrament be reserved. The chapel in the case of the cathedral is separate from the nave and the altar itself, but it's organically connected. You simply have to walk around that wall to walk back into the tabernacle, the reservation space.
Marty, if I could just for a second on that slide. You asked earlier about what the question about the old altar. This piece right here is part of the old altar, but there was a major marble and imagery that was extending clear up into here. So all of this right here replaces that imagery that was there, and it very well does not call attention to itself now, which is that altar was left there.
Yeah.
You can kind of say there's. It's a little confusing here, isn't it? You know, here's this altar still there, which I thought, what's it wrong with it? If we just don't have to use it, it's beautiful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the fact that they subtly brought it down to a level and then gave the honor of burying the first bishop, Bishop Lawrence Scanlon, is buried in behind that altar, a very special honor to that particular bishop who really gave his blood and life to getting the cathedral up and dedicated in the year 1909, which is the origins of the cathedral. That's the original dedication time. So in churches that have been built recently, I think the tabernacle the point is the tabernacle should be in the sanctuary. It is located, if it is located in the body of the church, and this is St. Francis of Assisi in Orem, it requires careful planning, and I think they've done a spectacular job here. Anyone from there goes there? They did a wonderful job of designing this church, I think, because the tabernacle is stored, so this is the whole view, and then this is the chapel that's dedicated to the Blessed Sacrament tabernacle, and it does not in any way distract from the main altar, and it is by design, the architectural, when you have an arch over something, that's a, that from antiquity, that was making it a special place. It is the equivalent of putting heaven over whatever space you're encompassing. And so it marks out that as a special place. And then, like I said before, lighting. Lighting can make a terrific difference. And this invites you in a very soft way to understand the tabernacle is right there, always available for people to come in and reverence that. Now, we go back to Mike at this point. I'm going to do I'll wrap it up with a very, normally we go to the cathedral and do a tour of the cathedral, which we can't do today.
No, they have a quinceanera.
My next scheduled tour of the cathedral is June 10th, in case everybody has any time that day.
What time, Mark?
It's 12:15. Okay. It's right after the 11 o'clock Mass.
June 10th.
And you would get all the particulars, and I'll give you some more at the end of this with a handout that you can go home and look at and get a lot more out of something like a tour, as best we can, close as we can come. So I'll turn it back over to Mike now and move on to the next slide for him to finish.
Is Monsignor Manning still getting some of those? He was for a while.
Tours?
Mm. Yeah.
He was for a while, and I think, well, he had some health issues, I think, and I'm not sure.
So it's after 11 o'clock Mass?
After 11 o'clock. Not every Sunday, and it's not always me, but there are frequently tours. I know for the next month, roughly, there are no tours scheduled for some reason. But it's 12:15, right after the 11 o'clock Mass. There's a tour of the cathedral given by a number of, there's four of us that do the tours. And they're all very happy presentation. So it's.
I want to go just to hear about Station of the Cross.
Oh, yes.
Way different.
If you had a group of.
And if I had an interested group that we.
You could set it up, right?
We can set up a private.
That's what I was just going to say.
We do that like weekdays or whenever it might be convenient, like school groups.
Or RCA groups or youth groups, yeah.
So I could offer to the adult faith or something.
You could, you just need to.
And you and Marty's aid.
Yeah, you just contact the cathedral early and say, I've got a group, love to bring them in on a Tuesday night. And if it's free and they have someone, they'll do it.
The scheduling of the cathedral is important.
But we always encourage you to take your RCA people.
Yeah, and you're most welcome anytime.
Okay, Mike.
So now we're at the part where we look at some of the peripheral elements. We can celebrate the Eucharist, some version of the Eucharist, without Stations of the Cross, as an example. But it fulfills, I think, expectations of history and culture and our experience that it's very common that we see most of these other elements included in the design of churches. So there should be a crucifix that's positioned either on the altar or near it, and clearly visible to the people gathered there. Once again, these are quotes. This is not, I didn't get to make this up, neither did Marty or...
And that's actually based on the germ, on the general instructions.
Yeah.
And so it is, typically, in a new church, we would try to do it with one crucifix, be that the processional cross or be it another cross. Sometimes you could do it with just a suggestion. If the corpus was hung on the wall, as it is here, maybe the processional cross doesn't have a corpus on it. There's any ways of doing it. The risen Christ is still accepted. It's a point of discussion for your church at your time with the bishop that's in place and the committee that's in place. Yes?
So I just had a question. what constitutes a crucifix? And the reason I ask is because I've seen now you have a cross, but the corpus is the risen Jesus that's on the cross. Does that qualify as a crucifix? Or does it need to be the nailed body?
That's a good question. That would be a point of discussion, I would think. Maybe one of those images should be the crucified. But I don't think there would be, I think if it was done appropriately, I don't think there'd be a big argument about that. Okay. And there isn't anything written that I know of.
That describes what a crucifix requires.
I'm sorry?
That describes what a crucifix...
Yeah, is that the nailed...
Yeah, I don't know that there is either. That's a good question, Mike.
But the whole notion of that, the big picture of that is discussed often. Mm-hmm. The Paschal candle, the living flame of the candle, symbolic of the risen Christ, reminds people that in baptism they are brought out of darkness into God's marvelous light. And we know that we see these... the candle is always near the altar. During the celebration of the Eucharist, during a baptism, that candle is moved. It's often put back with the baptismal font. Oftentimes you'll see baptismal fonts designed to accommodate it. I think St. Catherine of Siena, I think you can see that, the candle was actually in that basin. And the size of the candle should be the size appropriate to that space. It's probably not a bigger one in the diocese than the cathedral uses. And it's burned a lot there. But you know, smaller churches certainly have smaller paschal candles. Oops. Marty told me not to do that.
I just said that.
Stations of the cross offer a way for the faithful to enter more fully into the passion and death of the Lord and to serve as another manifestation of the Pilgrim Church on its homeward journey. So you can ask yourselves if you look at the stations of the cross someplace if it fulfills this mission. Here are a couple of the stations from St. Thomas More. This wasn't designed. I mean, the day we opened the church, we didn't have stations of the cross. But the artist that was, everybody fell in love with Ursula, and she was asked back. She did the crucifix there, and she did candles, and they were both made to be able to be processed with. But then later they asked her to do the Stations of the Cross, and she worked on these, and then every month or so, one of these was opened at the, church, all with a bit of a celebration. And in later years, she added the two statues that are on the right side of the church.
Is that the same material that the altar is made out of?
No. So these are a cast material. It's kind of like the cementitious, epoxy cementitious. They're lighter in weight. The altar there is granite, as is the base for the tabernacle, and the granite is in the same granite as in the baptismal font. But nonetheless, I think you bring up the point that it's a good example of how well these fit. They're not an item of themselves. They do relate. I think you feel comfortable that they complement one another, the coloring of that and the green in the granite. That's my opinion. Another total different way of looking at these. These are triptych Stations of the Cross at St. Mary's of Assumption in Park City. And once again, very custom to that church, custom to St. Thomas More. And that, I think that's an important thing to think about when you hire an artist, artists to do this work with you, craftsmen. This is one of a kind. There's no other church like this church. There's no other church like St. Mary's Assumption. There's no other church like St. Thomas More because of the effort they took to use local artists. You can go to catalogs and you can buy anything in there. Crucifix, candles, ambos, stained glass, and you might see that same stuff in any church in Indianapolis or Seattle, Washington. But I think it's important enough to say this church is of this people, of this diocese, of this locale, of this culture. And I can remember dedicating the church in, it's a very small church we did in Torrey, I don't know if you've ever been there, St. Anthony of the Desert, very small chapel. And a guy, one of the parishioners donated it, there was $100,000 to spend. The bishop can stay in a little apartment there, and the dining room becomes part of it. You open up after Mass. When the bishop dedicated that, not a Catholic that designed the altar, but they quarried a piece of red sandstone. Mm-hmm. And he made the crib wood that hold that up, this big doweled trestle that holds this altar up. And I can remember Bishop Wiegand with these robes on and reaching over that with the oil and oiling the top of this sandstone altar. You know, of the people of Torrey, Redstone, I mean, it just, it was a wonderful experience to see that. And of course, you can still see that altar there. Pushed the wrong way. Iconography, statues and shrines, the placement of those images can be challenging. And believe me, you'll see that all the time. It's a big challenge. You know, people might think, well, this ought to be up front, this is brand new. You know, don't confuse this iconography. It can help create the environment, but if it confuses what we're there for, it should be avoided. No bad art. Yes, sir.
I think I was told one time there should be only one image or statue per saint. Like, there should be one of St. Mary. There should be one of St. Joseph. I mean, if there is one, there should not be more than one. Is that correct?
It's actually in, there's actually in the guidelines, especially it's the image of Mary, correct, Marty? Marty wrote that little part in your guidelines there about it. And I'm not sure what page that is. But yeah, they're saying, I mean, how many statues? I mean, it all has to be weighed with the space and the number, but I think it's Mary is the only one that they say you shouldn't have multiple images of, correct?
Yes,
I think the cathedral has.
But they're the Cathedral of the Madeleine. See, that makes it a little bit different. But yeah, I don't know about other states. I'm going to have
probably a good guideline, but if somebody had reason to do other, you know, bring that to the committee and
it's on
talk about it.
Page 12.
Of just the guidelines.
Duplication of images of saints, for example, Marian images. Strongly discouraged.
Yeah. So, but as Mike said, if there was a reason, at St. John the Baptist we have a statue and then we have a window. So there are two different types of images in two different places, but there are two.
Restraint. Mm-hmm. That's a good. We can obviously overdo this as we do in our houses sometimes. Restraint is.
Every niche has a statue of Mary, right?
So I always wondered that. Like, Greg said, because, you know, we obviously have the crucifix, obviously, right? It's recorded. And you have this, and you have the, and we have a Last Supper, and then we have a Divine Mercy picture, and then we have another statue of Christ.
It can become cluttered.
You almost overdo it.
Yes.
And I don't know if it's wrong, or if I just don't care for it. I don't know what the answer is.
I don't either. Many cultures have a different aspect of what they think looks.
Yeah. Yeah.
I prefer minimalist. Some people prefer something else. So,
but really, the emphasis should be the Marian images should be kept down.
But you're St. Mary. You are also St. Mary.
Yeah.
At Westington. So, you could have more than one image because she is your patron saint.
Photograph looking straight up in
the
transept. Yeah, we're all pointed in this same direction.
That's right above the altar.
Right,
right above the altar. And, I think it's very appropriate in that cathedral. And we're all looking for being with our Lord while we're here. And later on, and that's what I hope. That kind of says it for me today. All about heaven. A couple of other secondary issues, if you will, of a place for pastoral musicians. I think probably every parish does this somewhat differently. The documents are not absolute about this, but the guidelines would lead us towards saying those musicians, the people leading the singing, should be in a place where they can enhance the rest of us who can't sing, our participation. So you, I think you see a trend towards locating the choir and the musicians and the instruments in a place of visibility. The cathedral, you don't need to see the organ there to hear it. The cathedral, they still have a choir loft up here. And the original intent was is that the choir would be there. They built new tiers in there, they put lights in there, and the choir would be standing around the console of the organ. But as we moved back in, they tried the choir here, and they tried the choir in the transept and the apse. And they asked the people, they asked us, you know, what we thought. And everybody pretty much agreed that they heard the choir better when they were located here. And even though maybe not originally anticipated, it was able to accommodate that. And even though you don't see that choir because the screen is there, you do see Greg waving his arms once in a while, and that. But you do clearly hear those voices leading us in song from this space. Yes.
I just want to share with the group that if you ever decide to go to daily mass at the cathedral in the afternoon, a lot of times the children's choir will participate, and you'll be in prayer, and all of a sudden you'll hear these voices, and it'll knock you out. They are so good. It's like, I've never seen daily mass like this with this much participation. So it's quite an experience. We're blessed.
I think it went to sleep. Can someone just, there it is. Okay.
Because it's a sign we're supposed to. Ministers of music most appropriately located in a place where they can be part of the assembly and have the ability to be heard. I was in a church this winter in Mesa, and there was a stage, this is a relatively new church, there was a stage behind the altar, and here was the musicians up there, and there was the guy that was the choir director, and he was more animated than you ever imagined. And here's the priest trying to celebrate, and this guy back there, it was a circus up there. And then, I mean, that was, you couldn't have been more visible to help direct, but it took away from it. Oh, I couldn't wait to get out of there because he was so distracted. Seating, there's really no, you know, there's no norm for seating. It can radiate, it can be straight. Many times people focus on having fixed pews as opposed to flexible pews. Sometimes there's a mix of those to allow some flexibility. But if flexibility gets in the way of what we're there about, that's the point where you say flexibility's not the right thing to do. So fixed pews, flexible pews, kneelers are usually appropriate. There's many churches we have where flexibility at the Noon Center, you can't, if you kneel there, you kneel on the floor, and they do have carpet for that. Materials are not necessarily a given. Harder materials last longer. They express sometimes more beauty. There's more involved there with hard surface. Sometimes the acoustics are enhanced by hard surfaces. Carpet can be kind of dull. Some people say we'd rather have the quiet. Kids are making noise. The quiet. Some say it's easier to clean carpet than tile or terrazzo. So there's no given there. I think musicians will talk about reverberation, and they'll say we like to have harder surfaces to get some reverberation as long as it's balanced. Having an acoustic, not a vendor, but an acoustical consultant for particular acoustical situations is a good idea because you can get a balance there. Nobody, in the end, not everybody's going to be happy anyway.
So a plastic baptismal font will last forever.
And then accessibility. The documents clearly say that persons of all abilities, the converse of that is inabilities, but all abilities should be accommodated, and they should be able to participate fully in the celebration. I can remember way back when, as an architect, some priest saying, well, we don't need to do that. We don't have anybody with the disabilities. You know, the exact reason for that is because you don't accommodate.
Yeah.
And think about how many people you don't accommodate by not providing accessibility. So we're seeing some of these older churches being renovated. The cathedral had some limitations to live with, but you can get on the altar. You have to start out there, but St. Vincent's, we're working on it. We're putting a ramp so that everybody can celebrate, regardless of their abilities. Marty?
Yeah. So at this point, we would be heading over to the cathedral for a tour, and I just want to take a minute to point out some of the things that I think are important things when I give a tour. First of all, pointing out the fact that the shape of the cathedral is a cruciform church plan. Secondly, that the bishop's chair or cathedra is central feature right behind the altar and elevated, and we have the shield of the bishop over the chair, and so it has a place of distinction. As I said, the term cathedral is a very special one in the Catholic tradition. We only have one cathedral in the entire state of Utah, which is the diocese. We are a huge diocese geographically. Another feature of the cathedral that we all may have an awareness of in general is the fact that this area over the entrance of the church is referred to in technical terms as the tympanum or the tympanum, has a lot of imagery on it, but I'd like to take a minute to explain it, and I want to explain to you at the same time, if you're furiously taking notes, you won't need to have notes for this part, because I'm going to send you home with a handout that specifically describes every little person that's on that. And I want to give you the overall view, so just kind of try and listen and take that in. You're going to go home with, there are three or four handouts here, and they're all very specific as to what we're seeing here. So this is the entrance, the overall entrance as we enter into the church. Essentially, we have here the history of early Christianity. Christ is pictured as a king with a crown. One hand is blessing, the other hand is holding the book of Revelations that has seven seals on it. Christ is standing on the orb of the earth. Christ is king of heaven and earth. Okay, he's the essential figure in establishing the Christian tradition. Then we see that the tympanum is divided into two horizontal bands. The lower band features the 12 apostles. They're taking the faith from the time of Christ forward into their lifetime. The upper band has five Latin doctors of the church, and they are labeled on your handout. They are Gregory, from left to right, Gregory, Jerome, Augustine, and Ambrose. So these four figures are Latin doctors of the church, and they take the church from the time of the apostles to approximately the year 500 AD. So this is the early Christians establishing and making the faith certain and carried forward in time. There are symbols of the four evangelists here. The symbols are related to each of them. Matthew is always associated with an angel. There is a lion here. Matthew, Mark is a lion. Luke is an ox, and John is an eagle. So anytime you see one of those in a church, start looking for the other three. If I find the eagle, I'm starting to look, where else in that church will I find the others? Because they're going to be in four corners or in the area. You can always count on that. So they're the evangelists who wrote the books that take the faith forward from that point in time. So we have here, as we enter the cathedral, the suggestion Gothic churches where these first appeared would have been the places that people learned their faith. They didn't read, so they took imagery and they incorporated that into their spirits. And when they entered the church, the suggestion is, think of all these really good role models of early Christianity and take them with you as you enter in. Now it's your turn. You're carrying the faith forward in your time. So I think it's an important thing to point that out on the exterior of the cathedral. Another fact of the cathedral that not everyone knows is that the original cathedral was built with stained glass windows on all of the walls. Side walls, the area that's in the sanctuary, that was originally stained glass windows. The program for the windows was created by Bishop Scanlon, the first bishop, and the program was dedicated to the mysteries of the rosary. So, as you can see from this photograph in 1909, we can see the windows that were in place. When the bishop died in 1915, the first bishop that is entombed in the church, the second bishop came along and he decided he wanted murals in that place. So by 1918, he had removed those stained glass windows that were dedicated in 1909 and had them replaced with murals.
That's where the tabernacle and the screen is now.
This is also the old-fashioned version of, there's the altar, and the tabernacle would have been on the altar.
But currently, that's the reservation chapel.
This is the Blessed Sacrament chapel.
Okay.
The current space here is completely redesigned as a result of the 1990 restoration and renovation. But I wanted to point out that these are that, so the Mysteries of the Rosary, and you'll have this on handout as well. The windows still in place are the Joyous Mysteries of the Rosary, the five events that are related to the Joyous Mysteries. The Sorrowful Mysteries encircled the apse area, and the Glorious Mysteries on the right-hand side as you enter are still in place. So we still have windows that were in place in 1909. These have been removed and changed to murals. And that's, I think, something that's worth knowing. The sad thing is, no pun intended, but it's a mystery as to what happened to those original windows. No maps.
No, that bishop didn't have to answer to anybody. He just
no, it's exactly what we've been talking about.
Yeah, nobody knows where they are.
And from 1909 to, we're in 1918 at this point, so. Or 2018, so 100 years, my 9-year-old grandson, I can exactly relate, he's just 9, and that's not so long ago. So it would have been, I think there's probably maybe the history of those windows is somewhere in the oral tradition of the people in the entire state, someone has an idea of where they went. The last slide I always take some time with, and space, of course, are the beautiful murals that do occur in this space that the windows used to be. And I want to just point out the basic theme of these murals that were put in place. The central section is dedicated to the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's the central image that we focus on as we're saying Mass and we see the Trinity directly overhead. On the right-hand side, there's a program for these figures. They come from the Old Testament time, and the figures on this side come from the New Testament time. And so we have a declaration of the essentials of the faith here, the support of the people that came before, and the people of the New Testament tradition, where we are associated more with that part of the tradition. And so we have on the exterior suggestions of people who have practiced their faith loyally, and we take them with us as we go in, and then we have witnesses all around the church from the former people that have practiced their faith, and they are witnessing with us the Eucharist. So it's an entire sort of encompassing and a way of having a communion with both the people and the witnesses that are observing from up above. to kind of bring the whole thing together. And that is where I will conclude at this point. As I said, each one of you is going home with a handout of each one of these last slides that, if you just pass these back.
Is that the mural of 1918, Marty, or has it been changed since?
Yes, okay. This is the mural of 1918. It was cleaned in the 1990s. And
I think she made one for each person.
There's one for each person. It's for each person, period. I mean, you don't have to put it in a lot of information. But it will give you all the particulars on the individual. So you can take time and look at the cathedral at your own pace. And if you please come to any of the tours at 12:15 on Sundays, mostly, not every single Sunday, and the one I will do is June 10th. So thank you for your attendance. Go ahead. Hang on.
One last question. On the Station of the Cross, on the third station, Peter has six fingers on one hand. How come?
You know, I don't know. We have this thing that's called artistic license. And sometimes artists make mistakes. So I have not looked at that one. The one that I hear more of six fingers, six digits, I should say, is related to the figure of Eve on the altar here, the Old Testament figure of Eve. If you look at the figure, this foot of Eve, that has six toes. I haven't looked closely at the image of, I'll look at that though. Number three.
I have heard that in the past, an artist purposely would make a mistake. Like an Indian like it.
If there was an intention, there could have been. And it's always artistic license as to what the artist decides to do. There has been a lot of misogyny at certain times in history. And Eve being seen as an evil woman is given an obviously a defect. And that might have been the case here. This artist was pretty good at the anatomy of the individual, so I'm not sure that was a mistake intentionally or by accident.
Yeah. Monsignor Benny does have there's a write-up on all of them. I'm not sure if it's included in there or not, but I don't have one of those. It would be nice to get one of them out, but they are available. Mm-hmm. Ask Drew.
Right. So, Mike, do you have anything to say, or Ruth, or where's Drew?
Well, they went to get Drew. Any questions or anything we didn't
cover? Okay. Things that you...
Because we've got a few minutes.
Not relative to anything Mike or Marty said. I'm just curious. An artwork in this mural, is there any significance why Old Testament is on the right, and or is it just because?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. You know how Mary's always on a certain side of an altar? When, you know,
yeah.
So is there any, no
case,
significance here?
In this case, I have no knowledge. The artist does talk about, there's a number of interviews that I've been reading about him and about his style. He does talk about the fact that the second bishop, whose name happened to be Bishop Joseph Glass, who took the stained glass windows. In this case, it does say that the artist pretty much decided what he put on, who he would select and put in the images, with the exception of a few that Bishop Glass said, I'd like to see this or that one there. But the artist pretty much takes credit for that and even suggests that when the murals were going to go up and he could see windows in that spot, he said, why don't we just cement that over? And that is what happened. If you go to the back of the cathedral, you can see the three windows where these now appear have been cemented over. But at the restoration in the 1990s, the people that did that drilled through that section that has been cemented over, and there are no windows in place there. So we don't know what happened to those windows, and that will always be a mystery. But there's no sense of, to me it would make more sense reading, because we read from left to right, Old Testament on the left and New Testament on the right. But that's the artistic choice he made. And no one objected, so there you go. It's kind of like a lot of things that have happened. So Drew, please, we're wrapping up.
Unless anybody has any other questions?
Unless we have questions.
Did you have any questions right now?
Or comments?
No, not really.
Okay, I thought I saw you raise your hand, so.
I didn't know that Sam Wilson had painted those.
Yeah.
He doesn't necessarily admit to it.